Don't tell me that you've never had an awkward moment with somebody like that. Maybe not exactly like that. Who likes goulash? It's pretty good. Eggplant. I like it. I'm not bad with goulash. That video beautifully illustrates something I said last week. And that illustrates this, that there are people all around you that you don't realize they would love an invitation to church. They would love anyone to invite them to anything. Now, some people are, you know, they wouldn't say, there's no way. It's apparently wealthy businessman lives next door or whatever, or the mom with like stellar kids and perfect teeth that you talk to only at the school when you drop off whoever, or the family down the street looks like they have it all together, etc. The waitress at the restaurant, the landscaper that cuts your lawn or whatever. You think people don't care, or do you think people would say no, or you think they'd reject you, but I got to tell you, there's a lot more people than you know that would be like, yeah, okay. Especially people that you know. Especially people that you live next door to. You know, neighbors, what have you. You don't know. These are the people, the ones I just mentioned. These are the people sitting in a crowded room, and they feel lonely. The people all around you, they feel trapped. Maybe they're stay-at-home moms, or they work around a lot of people, whatever, but they're just so alone. They don't have a single close friend. A college student surrounded by students in a dorm. You know what the suicide rate is? Higher than ever. How sad, right? You can be in a dysfunctional marriage and feel completely isolated with a giant family all around you. You could even walk a path of depression and sadness while you're immersed in ministry. All this is true. What am I trying to say? I want us to remind ourselves that there's an urgency, and there's people all around us, and they need us to talk to them about what's coming. The question last week was, how many can I take with me, right? There's this urgency. Just, can we repeat this question together real quick? Just repeat this after me. How many people can I take with me? Listen, if you're gonna have a Super Bowl party, oh, they're all coming. You're going to a buffet, hey, come eat lunch with me. They're coming. Amen. Why don't we understand that God's urgency should be ours? His priority should be my priority. The thing that Jesus cared about most is the thing that I should care about most. Because this life is short, but eternity is eternity. Doesn't stop, right? The second most important question I can ask myself is the one we just said. How many people can I take with me? The second? Yeah, the second. Because the first one, of course, is where am I going when I leave this earth? And if you can't answer that, then we got issues. Now, real quick, as I was preparing for this morning, God put this in my heart, so I'm going to share it very quickly. And it doesn't quite fit, but it's important that I share it. Listen, that most important, where am I going when I leave this earth? If somebody ever says to you, you can't really know if you're going to heaven. You can't really know. You do the right things, but how can you really know if you're going to heaven? Then I would say, if you're asking that question, you're not reading your Bible. Why? Because 2 Timothy, read them this. 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 12 says, that is why, remember we talked about this last week. The apostle's sitting in Rome. He's a prisoner. He's writing to Timothy to encourage him. That's the setting for this letter. But 2 Timothy 1:12, that's why I'm suffering as I am. He's having a bad time of it. Yet this is no cause for shame. Why? Because I know whom I have believed in, and I am convinced that he's able to guard what I've entrusted him until that day. And then read them this. I'm not sure. How can I know? 1 John 5:13. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you may know that you have eternal life. There's a confidence in there, built in right into the Word of God. If you're not sure, that's a problem. It means you're not. But listen, here's the thing. Let me be very careful here. If you're uncertain whether you're saved or not, listen, God loves you, and one of the devil's primary modes of attack is to cause you to doubt. It's to cause you to feel like, you know, I'm so imperfect. I struggle with stuff. Who doesn't struggle with stuff? Nobody in here doesn't struggle with anything. But that doubt comes from Satan, not from Christ, not from the Lord, who wants to fill you full of confidence. Romans chapter 8, verses 16 says this, the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are what? God's children. You accept Christ, you pray the prayer. Does that magically make you saved? No. But if you did that prayer sincerely, and your next moments begin to change, and you begin to live for Christ, are you saying, wait a minute, Pastor, are you saying you have to act or gain or somehow win salvation? No, you're saved by grace. We're going to get into this a little bit later. But once you genuinely give your heart to Christ, which is free, and he saved you through grace, then your life will change. If it doesn't change, you take the grace and you give it back. And you say, you know what? I like my old life better. Because grace will change you. Forgiveness will change you. And how do I know that? We'll read about this later, as I said, because the Bible says that your tree, let's just all pretend we're trees. Everybody go like this. You know, you look ridiculous. Put your hands down. My son, the other day, my son was out, and I used to joke with him, and I forgot that I did this. So Jaden goes by a minivan, and he puts his hands right by the minivan, and he like gets real close and stops moving. He's like, look, I'm a ninja. You can't even see me. And I used to do that, and I'm like, well, Jaden, where'd you go? Anyway, listen, you're a tree, and the Bible compares us to trees, and he compares the fruit that comes off that tree to good fruit or bad fruit. So the truth is this, you can know if you're saved or not, with all the confidence that God gives us, but there's a secondary method that other people will know whether you're saved or not. And we don't walk around judging, we walk around loving. But if I see somebody that I love and they claim to know Christ and I look at their life and I go, man, that is some rotten fruit, you better believe we're talking. Because your tree will have good fruit if it's planted in Christ. But if it's not, your life will have bad fruit. And people will see it. It's not all about that. We're not trying to please people. We're trying to please Christ. But Christ sees it too. Let me move on. If you're today here not quite certain that you're not saved, you're actually not sure. Even with all the verses we just read, you're actually not sure if you're saved or not. Don't leave this place today without talking to me. Don't. So here we go, week two. Last week, we talked about it. What is it? Love, right? Love. What is it? 1 Corinthians, the marriage verse. We went all through that. Love is patient. Love is kind, on and on. This week, how do we love? How do we love? So my text is Galatians chapter 5, verses 16 to 25. We're going to pick out of it, but we're going to read the whole thing. Galatians chapter 5, verses 16 to 25. In the NIV version says this, so I say, walk by the Spirit. And all the while, by the way, as we're going through today, remember that the question is, how do I love? Here it is. Let me read. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you're not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Well, let me stop there for a second. What does that mean? What does that mean? Well, if we're led by the Spirit and we're not subject to the law, then you can do things. You can do things that number of years ago we could not do. What do you mean, Pastor? I mean, legalism is not holiness. But when you walk by the Spirit, God's going to draw you towards doing good things. Legalism is not holiness. A number of years ago, women couldn't be out with in the church, that is. Women couldn't be out in the church without a dress on. They had to be dressed, couldn't be pants. They had, in Italy, listen, I was raised like this. You had to, women wore a veil over their head, right? And they, for all the world, many of, you go back into these small towns in Italy, you'll still see that. They're still dressed in dresses and veils, right? And that's okay. I'm not going to fault them for it or anything. But guess what? That doesn't get you in or out of heaven. Neither one. And legalism doesn't work. You say, you can't do that. You can't go see movies. You can't go do this. You shouldn't drink wine. The Bible doesn't say any of that. Do we get that clearly? Do not add laws to Scripture. Do not add them. It's not our right. However, when I read this, if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law, but you're led by the Spirit. And guess that, what's that mean? It means what you do will honor Him. You want to have your glass of wine? Have it. But when you overdo it, you're sinning, you're dishonoring God now. But if you're led by the Spirit, you'll know when to say, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to wear that. That's inappropriate here. I don't want to be a stumbling block to someone else. You're led by the Spirit. Be very careful, because we add so much. Why are you bringing that up now? Because if you're trying to witness to your neighbors, don't add laws to it. You're trying to invite somebody to church, don't make the rules up as you go along. The Bible's real clear. It's clear. Don't add your own stuff. Well, when I was raised, this is what was right, and I'm pretty sure rock and roll is of the devil. Are you kidding me? And rap. Oh, rap definitely must be of the... Well, we need to pray for our board member that he gets saved by the end of the service. You know, as funny as that is, here's the truth. What appeals to me, oh, that's okay. But if something bothers me a little bit, oh, that's sin. Don't add rules to the... You can't invite anybody to church. You cannot invite... You can't love somebody and your neighbor and be real with them and be normal with them. Say, come to church with me. If they're watching your life going, you are weird. And the Bible's not. The Bible's not. Yes, we're a little odd. But a little. Maybe more than a little. But the truth is, at the end of the day, if you don't add laws, if you don't add rules, just do what the Spirit leads you to do, you'll be all right. You'll be okay. Verse 19, let me move on. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, and debauchery. Verse 20, idolatry and witchcraft and hatred and discord and jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissension, causing division, dissension, factions, again, causing divisions. I don't like it the way he does it. I think the pastor's wrong. I think this woman's wrong. I think that ministry leader should do it another way. And you're talking to other people about it, and you're raising awareness to your cause, and you're causing a split. And Satan chuckles, and God hates it. Dissensions, factions, verse 21, and envy, drunkenness. That's true. Remember, I mentioned wine, so let me just hit this. It's not that God said, don't do this and this and this. He said, do it the right way. Do it the right way. Orgies and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of love. And then here we go. Here's the main crux of this verse. But the fruit of the Spirit is what? Love. Love, that's the first one. And then joy and peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. Those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. All right. So you know today's main thought is, what is our willingness and our capacity to love? That's what the next 4 weeks are all about, our neighbors, right? If we care for our neighbors, and last week I asked a question, and I said, how many of us love our neighbors? And not too many hands went up, and then I said, "What?" Like, at least on one side, and everybody went like this. So I actually have a test for you, because I realized many of you like one neighbor and not the other. What I'd like you to do this week is this: go on Facebook, post, I love one of my neighbors, and then see what the other neighbor does. See if they know which one is which. See if they can tell. No, don't do that. Don't do that. Don't do that. Today's main thought is, if we love the people around us, we're going to treat them a certain way. We're going to draw them. We're going to want to do what we need to do to care for them and how we love them. If we are doing what we're supposed to do, if we're walking with Christ the right way, then our love for the people around us will naturally grow with us. God will teach us. He'll show us. He'll say, you're following me. You're being faithful. Now share it. Now be infectious with your faith. Now love on people and help them and care for them. But from Scripture that we just read, within the scriptures that we just read, we can see how the love that we have and the love that the world has is very different, because the world has a lot of counterfeit love going on. The world has a lot of counterfeit love. You could do whatever you want. You could do whatever you want. And the Bible's not tolerant like that. I'm sorry. I didn't make the rules. Christ did. And the Word of God is very clear. It's tragic, and it hurts my heart when I hear somebody, you know, I'm gonna marry my dog. You think that's weird? There's people doing that. It started somewhere, though, because God's definition of what love and marriage was supposed to look like is very clear. But once you digress from God's plan, well, then you could do anything. Then you could fill in the gaps. I love my guppy. My guppy and I are intimate, and you don't know the conversations we have with my guppy. Listen, I say this tongue-in-cheek. I'm not trying to be hurtful, but at the end of the day, God has. Now, here's the thing. We don't judge the one that loves their guppy. We're not critical of them. We don't hurt them. We don't hate them. We love them. We love them, we treat them kindly, and we draw them towards what we believe is the truth. Because if you don't, then I guess you don't believe it's the truth. Because if you do read the Word and say, I believe this, I believe what Jesus said, then it's going to make you look around and go, I love these people. How can I not say anything? If I have the answer, if I'm able to save a starving man, a drowning man or woman, would I not do it? Of course I would. So what love is defined by the world is some pretty counterfeit stuff. Some pretty counterfeit stuff. But God has the real thing. Are we real or are we counterfeit? I talked about a tree a second ago, whether we're a good tree or a bad tree, a good fruit or bad fruit, which leads me to the first point here, good tree versus bad tree. Or just kind of a second intro is what this is, but Matthew chapter 7, verse 15 to 22 says this. Matthew chapter 7, verses 15 to 22 talks about this. Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing. Oh, pastor, I'm not in ministry. This is not for me. Yes, it is. You can think you're saved and in essence be a false prophet by doing things the wrong way with your life. Everything can look great, but if you're not serving Christ in a genuine way and you're causing some of the dissension and things we talked about earlier, then you're a false prophet to the people that are around you. Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. They're people with agendas that are far more important than I love you and I love Jesus and I want to introduce the two of you. There are people whose agendas are not that. They've been serving Christ a long time, but that's not their agenda. And that's sad. That's sad. By their fruit, and it says, verse 16, by their fruit you will recognize them. Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, by their fruit you will recognize them. And we're going to skip that last part. Listen, at the end of the day, if a tree's producing bad fruit, you can't just pluck it and glue good fruit to it. The problem's not the fruit, the problem's the tree, right? And if in my life, I say to myself, when was the last time I told somebody about Jesus? When was the last time I led somebody to the Lord? When was the last time I sat with somebody and talked with them and developed a relationship and prayed with them and introduced them to Christ and helped them in that? When was the last time I did that? That's fruit. It's kind of rare. Shouldn't be. Should be rather common. When was the last time I just said to somebody, hey, I'm praying for you? And maybe they look at you weird, like you got three heads, whatever. But when was the last time you said to somebody something sincere about your faith, just to open the door? Hey, just come have a cup of coffee with you. It's not for us to ridicule or criticize or convince someone to be something they don't want to be. It's just, listen, you've heard this before, I'm one beggar showing another beggar where to go find the bread. That's it. That's what we are. The very first fruit of the Spirit mentioned, as I said, was what? Love. Now, it's Sunday morning today. Sunday morning, there's a lot of folks walking around all over this country, all over the world, and they're shiny looking, and they're all polished up, dressed nice, whatever, sitting in their pews, and they're going through the motion, but they're not loving people. They're not loving people around them. They're not doing what we should do to love our neighbors. They're not. They're too busy. They're too focused on something else. It's not good. It's not good. The outside doesn't necessarily matter so much as the inside. All those polished, shiny people that are going through the motions this morning, going to churches, many of them, there's legit Bible teaching going on this morning, and they love the Lord, and they're ministering, but many aren't, and that's sad. And that's sad, and I don't want us to be classified that way. I want us to do what we're supposed to, and that's to love people. That's to love our neighbors. And how to love is the question for today. So how do we do that? Well, the way Jesus did. He told us in John chapter 15, verses 12 to 17, he said this. Jesus said, my command is this, love each other as I have what? Loved you. Love each other the way I loved you. It was very simple. How do we do that? Well, three quick points and I'm done. Three quick thoughts. The first one is this. We love with touch. Matthew chapter 8, verses 2, a man with leprosy came and knelt before Jesus and said, Lord, if you're willing, you can make me clean. Let me read that again. Matthew chapter 8, verse 2, a man with leprosy came and knelt before Jesus and said, Lord, if you're willing, you can make me clean. Here's the thing, left untreated the way it would have been in that time, somebody with leprosy will die in about 10 years. You say, well, 10 years, there's scarier things. Yeah, that's not the problem. The problem is the living of the 10 years. That's so tragic. It starts with fatigue and pain in the joints. Scaly spots start to develop. This isn't for the faint of heart. The body becomes covered with lumps that are filled with pus. Your face changes shape. It resembles a lion. Leprosy still exists. It's treated differently, of course. There's a growth on your vocal cords, so even your voice changes. Your body starts to decompose. You lose fingers, limbs, and there's a stench that accompanies it of literally rotting flesh, and you're still walking around, but part of you's dead. And everywhere they went in that day, they had to yell, unclean, unclean, because it was so contagious. And that meant that no one was allowed to go anywhere near them. Certainly nobody was allowed to touch them. Matthew chapter 8, verse 3 says this. Remember, the idea here is love like Jesus loved. Well, Matthew chapter 8, verse 3 says this. Jesus reached out his hand, and he touched the man. I'm willing. Remember, the man said, if you're willing to heal me. Jesus said, yeah, I am. I'm willing. He touches him. He says, be clean. And immediately he was cleansed of his leprosy. Did Jesus need to touch him? No, he sure didn't. He didn't need to. He didn't have to touch him. He could have just said it. He could have blinked at him and he would have healed. He could have done whatever he wanted to, but he touched him. Why? Because the leper didn't just need healing from the disease. He needed healing from the physical rejection. And Jesus knew that. Listen, there's something about a loving hug, a pat, just an arm around somebody that brings comfort. Now listen to me very carefully, because this is a funny area. We want to love the way Jesus loved, and Jesus loved with touch. That does not mean find the most attractive person in the room and go comfort them. It's not what I'm saying. Be careful. I'm talking about, you know exactly what, yeah, now he's hugging his wife. That's great. Kudos to you. Listen. What I'm saying is, there is a way to be affectionate and warm and loving physically that's not inappropriate. Listen, let me tell you something. I see somebody in this church hugging each other wrapped up, and it's not your spouse. You be ready. I'm coming to talk to you. Why? Because that means something. It's not good. But a brother hugging another brother. You know, this is in this country, we made touch real weird. We grade everything. We've grayed the lines. There's no gender. There's no this. There's no that. Well, it makes everything kind of weird. Makes everything kind of funky, right? In Italy, my family, my relatives, even now when I go back, I see my uncle. They kiss me on both cheeks. It's a big wet one. And they love me. And I love them. It doesn't bother me at all. The men kiss each other on the cheeks. There's an affection there. I don't know if you know this. Now, they're on vacation, and when they get back, they can yell at me all they want. You know who loves to give me like a big wet smack on the cheek? You know, all of you know. Who is it? Rich Tremisi. The dude doesn't stop kissing me. And you know what? If you know Rich, he's such a sweet, loving man. And the first time he smack, I'm like, whoa, what was that? Was that what I thought it was? Yeah, because the second time he did it, I was like, oh, yeah, okay, all right, he's a kisser. Fine. But here's the thing, there's nothing wrong with that. How tragic, how sad when like a dad won't hug his son because he's a teenager. Are you kidding me? Or kiss his son because he's too grown or whatever. I've already warned Julian. I don't care where he's at, how old he is. We'll be. I'm going to give him a big smack on the cheek and squeeze him. He's my son. I'm going to love him till Jesus comes back. I don't care about that stuff. But there's a warmth. There's an affection. There is a proper amount of encouragement that comes through touch. Elderly people, young people, kids, it doesn't matter who it is. Properly. Properly. Not improperly done. Not improperly done, but the way Jesus did. With love. You can love through touch. It's absolutely true. There's a story. You know, even in, you know, I do a lot of counseling, including marriage counseling, and there's a lot of couples will come in and they'll talk to me, and I'm going to get a little, how old is the oldest, youngest person in this room? I guess old enough. Listen, when I counsel somebody, a couple that's married in our office, I won't say anything too explicit here. One of the first things I ask a married couple who's going through troubles is, are you having sex? Why do I ask that? Because there is a physical, intimate, healing, spiritual thing that God designed between a wife and a husband that heals things during that time. Pastor, this is weird. Listen, I talk to people who've had trouble for years. When was the last time you hugged? I'm asking and they're like, "Well, we don't really touch anymore." How sad is that? There is power in just a caress. Listen, I get so tired. This is about to turn into a whole different sermon. But I'm gonna go there anyway. I get so tired, right? And I'm in bed, and I realize I didn't even hug Andrea today. She's out cold, right? She's got her laptop in front of her because she's that diligent, but she's out cold anyway. She turns into a stroke victim with like her computer. She works so hard, and I feel for her, but all right, stop yucking it up, and don't tell her I said this. She'll be mad. Listen, but the truth is, even in that moment, I'm like in a dead sleep, I'm in a stupor, and I go, I didn't hug her. So now I'm like looking for her, right? Now I'm just finding, oh, there she is. And I just put my hand on her, and it makes me feel better. And I don't know if she's awake or not, right? I don't even know if she's awake or not. But I pray for her, and I love her. Touch means something. Is it just me? Is it somebody? Like, do you get what I'm saying? God designed you that way. Love the way Jesus does mean to love through touch. All right. Again, you don't go on a subway and, like, meet a stranger and be like, come here. No. That's not what I'm saying. But there is... You know what I'm saying. Number two, love by listening. Love by listening. This is a big one. Most people don't listen with the intent to understand. Again, you're saying, Pastor, I'm not a counselor. You are. I don't really care about this stuff. Doesn't matter. As a counselor, most people have learned, as counselors, you have to listen to understand. But most listen with the intent just to reply. Listen to me. If you soak this in, it will help you. Pastor, isn't it the same? Isn't it the same that listening with the intent to understand versus listening with the intent to reply? No. Because if you listen with the intent to understand, a reply might not be necessary. What do you mean? What I mean is they just want somebody to care about them. They just want somebody that loves them to understand and hear them. It's kind of the difference between men and women, many times, not all the time. But some of the difference between men and women is a man will share because he's venting and he's just talking. And then, you know, the woman might say, well, honey, you should do this and this and this and this. And the man doesn't really want an explanation. He just wants to blow off steam. He just wants to vent a little bit. He doesn't need you to fix it. He just needs you to listen. And it goes both ways. Okay, that's a private session. We'll talk about that later. Listen. It goes both ways. A woman might say something, and a man would say, you know what, let me really listen to what she's saying. Let me give you a scripture verse for this, in case you're wondering. To love like Jesus loved. Listen to this. These two guys are walking down a road, depressed, lonely, in the book of Luke, chapter 24, verse 7 to 19. They're walking down this road, these two lonely, sad, depressed guys. And Jesus asks them, what are you discussing together as you walk along? They did not know it was him. They didn't know it was Jesus. They stood still, their faces downcast. And one of them, named Cleopas, asked him, are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who doesn't know what happened in these days? What things? Jesus asked. Don't you think he knew what happened? Hello, it happened to him. Why would he say, what happened? What things? Tell me. Because he needed them to share what was on their heart. He wanted them to speak. A good communicator, somebody that loves the people around you, even at work, are you going to ask questions that draw out what they're trying to say? That's a knack. That's a knack. There's a gift for that. It gets better as you practice. We need to practice. And I love that. Jesus knew what things. He was drawing them out. The best communicators are the ones, the best counselors, the best anything, are the ones who they hear, and they don't necessarily go to fix anything or even give you an answer. Just, your heart's heavy. My heart's heavy for you. That's it. Right? And Scripture points that out in other places. Rejoice with those who are rejoicing and weep with those who weep. It seems easy, but it's not quite. Number three, finally, love with your time. Jesus was always going somewhere, but he never seemed to be in a rush. Did you ever notice that? Today's day and age, we're rushing around like headless chickens. Ships passing in the night in our house all the time. Who's got the kids? You got the kids? Do I got the kids? Where are the kids? Julian's got, where are they in the house? Like she's got to go out. She's got New Jersey Women's District stuff. I've got a board meeting. She's got this. She's got that. We're juggling schedules. And at the end of the day, it's like, Lord, what happened? Is this the way it was supposed to be? And in the end, the only thing we can do to prevent that is to say, no, I can't do that. I'm not going there. I don't have time to do that. Is it important? Is it valuable? Yes, but if we're loving people with our time, then we have to make certain that there's enough time slotted out in our schedule to do that, right? When speaking to a crowd, look, this is what it says here. He didn't rush. And speaking to one, he's speaking to a crowd, Luke chapter 5, verse 17. He's preaching. He's doing his thing. Now, I imagine he did not have a laptop. I'm sure he didn't have notes. I'm sure he didn't need them. But he's speaking to this crowd of people, and he's ministering to them. And in the meantime, this group of people who want to get this paralytic to him cut a hole in the ceiling and lower this dude through the roof. And Jesus stops, and he heals him. And he just stops. He's not in a rush. He's not in a rush to get back to his revival service. He's just going to do what he needs to do right then. He even when he's asleep, he's obviously not rushing. Luke chapter 8, verses 22 to 24. The disciples are fearing for their life. It's the middle of a storm. You know these stories. And Jesus is what? Snoozing. He's asleep. And Jesus knew. If that doesn't tell you that naps are of God, you're a heathen. You just need to get saved. Right? Even when he's on his way to perform another healing miracle, he was on his way to heal a 12-year-old little girl. Luke chapter 8, verse 43. Yeah, Luke 8, 43. He's on his way to heal this 12-year-old little girl. He's going through this crowd, and a woman with an issue of blood for many years touched the hem of his robe, and he stops. You know the story, too. He stops, and he said, who touched me? And his disciples are thinking, are you nuts? You're in a crowd. Who touched you? But he knew, and he stopped. Now, he was on his way to what? Something important. He was on his way to something of a great magnitude. He's going to heal a 12-year-old little girl, but he still stops. Why? Because he cared enough to love this woman with his time to say, you know what? This is important. This is important. That can wait. I'll get to that when I get to that. But this is important too. And he heals this woman, right? Folks, we need to slow down. Some of us need to slow down. Now, some of us need to hurry up. Some of us just need to stop, like, lollygagging around. Laziness is a thing, too. But that's not what we're talking about today. It's not what we're talking about today. Sometimes we just need to slow down, stop, and ask ourselves again this question. Are we loving people with our touch and by listening and with our time? Are we doing this? Are we doing what Jesus, are we loving the way Jesus loved? Is that what we're doing? Or do we have so many things that are so important to us and we've stacked them all in front of these things? And in terms of priority, these are kind of at the bottom, to love people for Christ's sake with touch and listening and our time and in Christ's name to give them that spiritual type of love that they need. We're just too busy for that. We got too many other things in the way. Our focus is somewhere else. That's the question. You know this. My father passed away this past Thanksgiving, and I didn't see it coming, and it hurt me deeply, but I'm also grateful for what God did and took him home. I'm so grateful about this one thing, though, and that's why I'm sharing it. In his mercy, God gave me this strange sense of urgency for the last 3-4 years. You can ask Andrea. Before that, I would see my parents maybe, I don't know, Thanksgiving, and possibly, you know, whenever they came up here. That's when I would see my folks. That's it. I would see them all, and we're busy, and we're doing this, and we're doing, it's far, and I'm just not going. But for the last 3-4 years, I had developed this urgency in my heart that I would go see my parents all the time. Every couple weeks, every couple months, if I was overly busy, I would take a 2-hour drive and go see them, do some work at the house. And I've shared this, what God did in my relationship with my dad was amazing. It was phenomenal. It was an absolute, utter, complete miracle. The way my father and I began to relate after an entire life of just hell with that. What I meant to him and what he meant to me, it was hellish. It was awful. It was hateful. It was vicious and violent and awful. And did he love? I thought your father was saved. He was in his way. It was tough. It was later that he changed. And later that he changed towards me. Why? Because I loved him not only with my words, but with my time. And I shared this too before. I never hugged my dad. I must have been 25, 26, 27 years old when I finally began to hug my dad in a real way. And dad, I love you. And he's like, what are you doing? This is not manly. And everything changed. Everything changed. This is real, not just through scripture, but through my own life. And it's true through your own life, because many of you have proven this and played it out as well. I continue making the 2-hour drive to see my mom often, because I never want to look back and regret that I didn't love her with my time. I never want to do that. I'll close with this. And we'll just play something in the back there. But whether it's a family member or an actual neighbor, my neighbor's here today. Good morning. How are you? It's good to see you. Listen, the other neighbors must not like me. No, I'm just kidding. They're very sweet. I love both of our neighbors. They're great. It's the groundhogs behind me that I want to hit with a nuclear bomb. But anyway, whether it's a family member, an actual neighbor, maybe even a complete stranger, you have to ask yourself this question, and this is the end of the service. Are we loving each other the way Jesus loved us? If last week the question was, what is it? And we described it from the love verse and the marriage verse, we talked about that. If the question this week is, how do we love? Then the answer is the way Jesus did. And I just touched the surface. He loved with his time, he loved with his touch, he loved with his time, touch, and what was the other one? Thank you. Just making sure you're listening. And you were. Thank you. And John chapter 15, verse 12, 17. My command is this. Love each other as I have loved you. It's a big deal. It's a big deal. Will you pray with me? Bow your heads for a second. And we're done here. Father, I ask you that. I just ask that you would soften our hearts, will you? God, I ask that many of us in this room do these things. And I thank you for that. I encourage them to continue doing that. I pray that you'd bless them. I pray that you'd bless them for loving people with their time and their touch and by listening and just by loving the way you loved us. And I thank you for that. But I ask God for those that might be struggling in this room to make this work. I ask that you would give us a different perspective, that you would help us to slide our priorities around. So many times, Lord, I have an idea in my head that I think is so important. Until you show me it's not. And God, we just ask for that kind of clarity. Help us. Help us to love the people around us. Help us to love on our kids, whatever age. Help us to love, whatever condition of their life. Help us to love on them deeply, consistently. I pray that you'd help us to love our neighbors and just to be kind, just whether it's a mailman or a landscaper or a clerk or a waitress, or help us to wear our love on our sleeve. And that we might, in that way, reflect who you are in us. I thank you, God, in advance for this whole series. What is love? How do we love? How do we think about our neighbors with the urgency that you do, oh God? We love you. We ask you to bless this word, bless these thoughts, bless this time together, that you would just let it sink into our heart. Change us. God, whatever you need to do in us, to challenge us, to sharpen us, to make us better. Change us. Give us a hunger to read the word so that we would know how to understand what's counterfeit and what's real. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you this morning. Listen, we want to encourage you to be with us for our midweek service. Bolt for kids, K through 6, worship and discussion for the rest of us on Wednesday night. This past Wednesday was fun. I encourage you to come back and do it again this Wednesday. God bless you. We'll see you Wednesday.